Thank you. So this is the Heart Sutra, but we don't...
I know that.
Yeah.
The short version.
Yeah, the mantra.
Yeah, that I know.
Okay. So welcome. I want to welcome everyone. And I'm actually so happy. Actually, we've already been having a lot of fun the last few hours, including falling sound asleep. I finally got some rest when Krishna Das is here. Back, we go back to 1971 in the Kumaon Hills, and that he could join this force for good. You know, this is the context of the last session of the Force for Good series, 18 classes that we did this spring, in honor of His Holiness's, the Dalai Lama's, initiatives, the Buddhist sources of those initiatives, sort of, or you could say the Indic sources. And KD coming, Shri KD coming and joining us at the end as a celebration of this force for good in the midst of all of the crazy things that are going on from the leaderships on this planet, which are really, they think they're a few centuries behind the times, actually, basically all of them, at least, maybe a few millennia behind the times, back in the time of Mahabharata or Trojan War, basically. And I'm just so thrilled that he's here. I'm really, really delighted. And he has some tremendous treats in store. I asked him before to work on some, because I always have felt that you know, the chants that he does and the melodies are these ancient Indian things. And it has been a dream of mine in life to do something which I've utterly failed in doing, of course, this life. I'm always a few lifetimes ahead of myself. I'll get there. I'll get there two or three more lifetimes from now. But that was to restore to the great Mother India the 1,500 years that she had with the combination of Buddha and Hanuman and Vishnu and Shiva and whatever, you know, they're sort of like this little bit vestige left in Nepal, and I discovered in Bali where the Buddhist-Hindu kind of thing is in beautiful harmony. Uh-huh. And there's a beautiful counterpart to it, you know, counterpoint to it. But so it is in the spirit of that we're doing this now. And His Holiness the Dalai Lama and His Force for Good in India itself, you know, he always says to people that he's not just some kind of guy from some Buddhist sect in Tibet, you know. He's a son of India. He's a son of Nalanda University. He's a son of the great Panditas of Nalanda, you know, that which was the big Buddhist, the big Indian university, actually, of the first millennium, you know. And so we have India here today with KD and Nina Rao. She's Anandamayi Ma's reincarnation to me. I embarrass her by saying that, but she looks like that to me always. And she's another Ma, I think, you know. Anandama, anyway. Anandamayi just means made of joy, you know. That's what it means, Ma, mother made of joy.
Here they were made of almonds.
And my other friend here joining. But I forgot your name. Arjun with us. So then that's it. That's enough introductions.
I'm representing the Indian side via Long Island.
Yeah.
I once had a dream. I was being reincarnated, and I was heading right back to India.
Yeah.
And for some reason, at the last moment, I made a left turn and wound up in New York.
That's it. Here we are. This is another kind of Benares. Yes, indeed. Varanasi, it is indeed. Okay. So Master Maestro, where do you want to start? Actually, in the tradition of the class, we've read together, everyone, the Heart Sutra.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you want to go through the whole thing. Do you?
Maybe somebody has another copy that I could look at.
Can we have another copy? Tom, you can share that.
Thank you.
Oh, great.
Okay, good. Thank you.
So maybe we all do that together. Everyone does that. You should have had it on your chair. Everybody have the Heart Sutra. And I'll explain in all sessions of teachings, in Zen, in Tibet, everywhere, at the beginning of any teaching or any kind of event, they read this sutra. And the reason is that if there's any negative spirits around, they really don't like this sutra and they leave.
You want me to go already?
No. You're not going to leave. You're going to lead the chant. They always leave, and at the end you clap three times just to seal the deal.
Okay.
You know, like when the British invaded Tibet after they massacred a whole bunch of unarmed Tibetans on the way in, they marched into Lhasa and everybody was applauding. And they thought, oh, well, I guess we made a good impression. But actually, that was the last-ditch defense, was the clapping. Okay. Okay, in Sanskrit, should we just do it like that? Okay, in Sanskrit, everybody together now. No lazy people without your lips moving. Come on. In Sanskrit, Bhagavati Prajna Paramita Hridaya. In Tibetan, Chonden Dema Sera Parchin Ningbo. In English, the Blessed Lady Buddha, Heart of Transcendent Wisdom. Thus did I hear on a special occasion, the Blessed Lord was dwelling on the Vulture Peak at Rajagriha, gathered with the great communities of mendicants and bodhisattvas. At that time, the Blessed Lord entranced himself in the teaching samadhi called Illumination of the Profound. Just then, the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, was contemplating the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, and he realized that the five body-mind processes are void of any intrinsic reality. Thereupon, impelled by the power of the Buddha, Venerable Shariputra addressed the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, thus, when any noble son wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, how should he learn? And the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, yes, Venerable Sharadatiputra, thus, Shariputra, when any noble son or noble daughter wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, he or she should realize it in this way.
Those five
body-mind processes should be truly realized to be void of any intrinsic reality. Matter is voidness, voidness is matter. Voidness is not other than matter, neither is matter other than voidness. Likewise, sensations, conceptions, mental functions, and consciousnesses are also void. Shariputra, thus all things are voidness, timeless, uncreated, unceased, stainless, impeccable, undecreased, and unincreased. Shariputra, thus in voidness there are no matter, no sensation, no conception, no mental function, no consciousness,
no eye, no ear,
no nose, no tongue, no body, no mentality, no form or color, no sound, no scent, no taste, no texture, no idea. There are no sense media from eye to mentality sense media, and there are no consciousness media from visual to mental consciousness media either. There are no ignorance and no cessation of ignorance and no
up to old age and death
and no cessation of old age and death either. Likewise, there are no suffering, no origination, no cessation, no path, no intuitive wisdom, no attainment, and no non-attainment either.
Therefore,
Shariputra, because the bodhisattva is without attainment, she lives in reliance on transcendent wisdom. His spirit is unobscured and free of fear. Passing far beyond all confusion, she ultimately succeeds in nirvana. And all the Buddhas who live in past, present, and future rely on transcendent wisdom to reach manifestly perfect Buddhahood and unexcelled perfect enlightenment. Such being so, there is the mantra of transcendent wisdom, the mantra of great science, the unexcelled mantra, uniquely universal mantra, the mantra that eradicates all suffering. It is not false and should be known as truth. The transcendent wisdom mantra as follows, tadyata, om gate gate
para gate
te para samgate bodhisvaha, om gate gate para gate para samgate bodhisvaha, om gate gate para gate para samgate bodhisvaha. Shariputra, thus should the bodhisattva, the great hero, learn the profound transcendence of wisdom. Thereupon the Blessed Lord arose from that samadhi and applauded the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. Excellent, excellent, noble son. So it is, so it is.
One should practice
the profound transcendence of wisdom in just the way you have taught it. And even the transcendent Buddhas will joyfully congratulate you. When the Blessed Lord had spoken thus, the Venerable Shaladatiputra, the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, everyone in that audience and the whole world with its gods, humans, titans, and fairies rejoiced and all applauded what the Buddha said.
See, still here.
You didn't have to leave.
I'm still here. Fantastic.
Okay. Great. Don't worry, you're all still here. Just no eyes, no ears, no nose, and all that. But you're all here as relational entities, unsure of what you are.
This mantra?
Okay, you want to start with that? Yeah. Now this, yes, let me introduce it. KD and his infinite kindness agreed to work on chanting, finding a melody from his, you know, traditional body of melodies to chant the Manjushrinamasamgiti, the hymn of the names of Manjushri, a very wonderful, but it's much longer, but he picked a particular marvelous part which delineates in sound the Vajradhatu mandala jnana, the intuition of the mandala of the Vajra realm. And Vajra realm means the clear light of the void of which all of us are made, which is only known in bliss. We never can know it by any other way except through bliss. And, you know, Tantrayana is actually really called Mantrayana, you know, actually. Uh-huh. Tantra is a secondary name, Tantra, like Tsongkhapa's great paths of the mantra path, you know, his great treatise on that. So it's really Mantrayana. So this sound that we chose and that you now are going to do is delineates the Vajradhatu mandala of Manjushri. And what Manjushri is, the outer Manjushri is a bodhisattva of wisdom, who holds a sword, meaning the sword of critical wisdom, and the book of the mother of all Buddhas, the Prajnaparamita, or transcendent wisdom of selflessness and emptiness. And that's the outer Manjushri. The inner Manjushri is everybody's inner non-dual wisdom intuition, which everyone has, and which slips into the void and the clear light of the void. The void being sort of the deepest way of understanding reality. Because there's no disappearing from relative reality, actually. Matter is voidness. Voidness is matter. Uh-huh. Matter is not other than voidness. It's not like voidness is inside the matter or something. The matter itself is the voidness. Mm-hmm. So when one knows that matter in bliss, then one knows it as the clear light of the void, made of this infinite energy at the base of the universe, you know, which is the heart of Vishnu, Shiva, Hanuman, Buddha, Manjushri, whatever. And Manjushri is your own wisdom. Manjushri is what they call jnana sattva, the intuition hero that slips into that, but only never in the mode of subject-object grasping, oh, that's the void, or I know voidness, or that's the clear light, I know clear light, I'm enlightened, you know, this thing, this delusion that people sometimes fall into.
Yeah.
What they call what the Zen people call the demon ghost cave of thinking you're enlightened. Trapped there. And instead, you only slip into this knowledge through bliss. And everyone does whenever they feel bliss, true bliss, which melts them, you know, which they don't have, it which sweeps them away, if you follow me. Mm-hmm. And so a very direct way of sweeping them is singing from the heart, chanting from the heart.
Okay.
So anyway, you did the great honor and made me such a pleasure in doing this. And now we're going to chant together. And he's going to really chant. I'm riding shotgun, that's all. And he's really going to chant this Manjushri Namasamgiti, hymn of the names of Manjushri.
First of all, keep the gun loaded, okay?
What?
Keep the gun loaded. You're running shotgun, so keep it loaded. And I will I just want to do one invocation, and then we'll go into this, okay?
And actually, he insisted I sit here with him. I wrote him asking. I said I would introduce and sit down in the audience. And he said, listen, Tenzing Maharaj-ji, if you think you're not going to do something here with me, then you better check your bodhicitta. That's what he said. I've been laughing for 3 days since I got that email. I'm laughing. So anyway, here we go. Okay. Onward.
So first I'm going to do an invocation for my lineage. Let's just do some ohms together, okay? Oh. Pavana Kuma Kalavana Pavaka Gyanakan Jasu Hravaga Vasirama Savachapadhan Atulita Baladhama Himshala Badeham Tanu Javana Kushan Jnani Nama Draganyam Sakala Guna Nidhan Vanaranam Adisham Raghupati Priya Bhaktam Vata Jatam Nama Goshpati Kritavarisham Mashiki Kritarakshasam Ramayana Mahamala Ratnam Ande Nilatmajam Anjana Nandaram Viram Janaki Shokanashanam Kapisa Makshahanta Ande Lanka Bhayankaram Ilangya Sindho Salilam Salilam Yashokavahi Janakatma Jaya Adayatanil Dadahalanka Namamitam Pranjali Ranjaneham Manojavam Marutatulyavegam Jitendriham Budhimatam Bradishtam Vatatmajam Vanarutamukhyam Shri Ramadutam Sharanam Prapadhe Shri Ramadutam Sharanam Prapadhe Shri Ramadutam Sharanam Prapadhe Shri Ramadutam Sharanam Prapadhe Anjaneya Matipatalan Kanchanadrikamane Avigraham Parijati Taramuravasanam Bhavayami Pavamananandanam Yatra Yatra Raghunath Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Kritamastakanjali Vashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Martinamat Rakshasantakam Guru Bajaranda Bali Hanuman Ki Jai. Shate Shma Giram Pate Aye O E O Amahastito Hridi Jnanamurti Aham Buddho Buddhanam Trayadvavardhinam Om Vajratikshna Dukacheda Pragya Jnanamurtaye Jnanakaya Vagisvara
Arapachanayate namaha Iti maya jala bhivam bodhi kamagatas tisra Tadyata bhagavan buddha Sambhudo karasambhavaha Akara sarva varnakyo Maharta paramakshara Mahaprano yanutpado Vagudhahara varjitaha Sarva vilapahit vagriya Sarva vak suprabhasvaraha Mahamaharagaha Sarva satvaratinkara Mahamahamahadvesha Sarva klesha maharipu Mahamahamahamoho Mudhadimo asudana Mahamahamahakrodho Mahakrodhari purama Mahamahamahalobha Sarva lobha nishurdhana Mahakamo mahasokyo Mahamodho maharati Maharupo mahakayo Mahavarno mahavapur Mahanama mahodharo Mahavipula mandala Mahapragnya yudhadharo Mahakleshan kursogarnihi Mahayasham mahakirtir Mahajyotir mahadhyuti Mahamaya dharo vidvan Mahamaya artha sadaka Mahamaya arati rato Mahamayendra jalika Mahadhana pati shresto Mahashila dharo ghrni Mahakshanti dharo dhiro Mahavirya parakrama Mahadhyana samadhisto Mahapragya sharira dhrik Mahabalo mahopaya Pranidhir jnana sagara Mahametri mayo meyo Mahakaruniko gradi Mahapranyo mahadhiman Mahapayo mahakriti Maharidhi mayo malo Mahavego mahajava Maharidhi kumahesakyo Mahabala parakrama Mahabhavadrishambeda Mahavajradharogana Mahakruro maharaudro Mahabhaya bhayamkara Mahavidyo tamonato Mahamantro tamo guru Mahayana nayarudho Mahayana nayotama Iti vajradatu mangala jnana gata tisra chaturdasa Om marapachanadi Om Arapachanadhi 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 Arapachanadhi Om 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 Ar Arapachanadhi Om Arapachanadhi
Thank you. That's so nice. Actually, if everyone knew the Om Arabadhanadi, they could recite it like a chorus, you know.
Huh.
Om Arabadhanadi. It means, di means intelligence, huh. You know, genius, like wisdom, insight. And Arabadhana means the ripening of all beings. Sarva-sattva, ara is short for sarva-sattva. Bhajana means to ripen or mature, to cook, actually.
Bhajana, yeah.
Ara-bhajana, ara-bhajana, di.
Yeah.
Om, ara, everyone learn that mantra. Om, say, om, ara,
ara.
Bhajana,
bhajana,
di,
di,
with an H, di,
di,
like that.
Di.
Om, ara, bhajana, di.
Om, ara, bhajana, di.
Om, ara, bhajana, di.
Omara Pachanadhi.
And then the way you practice that, to if you need to sharpen your mind to meet some problem, you repeat the di very, very many times. And then when you graduate is when you can say it 108 times without drawing inhaling. In other words, like this. Omara Pachanadhi. Up to 108 times. That's when you graduate. and that's when you... And they do that for small children to prepare them for their studies. Because the sharpness of the tongue and the quickness of it, it sharpens your brain to learn something, to have insight in something. And you all have inner Manjushri. You can all understand everything. That's Buddha's great imperative to everyone, that we all have to understand everything. And that way we free, then we understand that everything is fine, actually. But we have to understand that, you know. And then deep faith comes from that understanding, not against understanding. That's the key thing.
Ah.
Anyway, Maestroji.
What would you like?
Hari.
Hari?
Yeah, Hari.
Uh-huh. Sure.
You know, I always complained, Shyamdas, our dear departed friend Shyamdas, I always used to complain to him that everyone goes Hare Krishna and Hare Rama, although I love doing that too, because I do love Vishnu too, especially in his Krishna form, most lovable. I'm a little bummed with Rama, the way he made Sita like prove herself or something after he fought. That bummed me out. But, you know, because I guess, I don't know, my Swedish wife has me semi-trained, you know. And so, but I love that Krishna, you know.
Yeah.
But then, you know, the ninth avatar of Vishnu in that view is Buddha. But nobody but Shyamdas ever went Hari Buddha. And you. Excuse me.
Okay.
You. They never did.
You know, in Vrindavan, Krishna's place, once a year they do this ceremony. They take through the, and they always have a float for all the avatars. And Buddha's right there.
Yeah, they have Buddha.
Yeah, they do that.
Yeah, Shyamdas freaked out when I went there. We went and saw that Guru.
Yeah.
And I had this conversation through Hindi.
That's because he had to admit Buddha and Krishna were equal.
And I complained to him, where's your Hari Buddha? Where's Hari Buddha? Hari Buddha.
Yeah.
And then I left 2 weeks later, Shamdas wrote an email, like all freaked out. Wow, they had a Buddha float and they brought it out.
Unbelievable.
I didn't believe it. Yeah. They did. Yeah. And they credit that guru, that particular guru who has passed since then, he credited Buddha with having helped India, the Vedic India, before his time. They were still, because they had come from the Central Asian steppes, you know, the so-called twice-born, the Dvijas, and the Vedic people, mm-hmm. and they still had a taste for barbecue. and then Buddha got them to stop sacrificing animals and got them more toward the vegetarian. He credited Buddha that.
Yeah.
And then he connected that, and once he delivered that premise, he said to me, therefore, please tell the Dalai Lama to get the Tibetans to stop eating so much meat here in India, they did subsequently, actually. So
really?
That was a wonderful thing that happened from Vrindavan.
You remember the time I said to you, you know, Bob, I heard that Shiva and Chenrezig Avalokiteshvara live on the same mountain. And he said to me, oh, yeah, but Chenrezig lives a little higher up.
No. That's a Buddhist tradition.
Yeah, you know? Buddhist tradition.
Yeah. They have that. That's Avalokiteshvara, you understand? Because the reason he's on the higher on the mountain is he has to look further all over the suffering being.
That's true.
You know, instead of Mahaishvara, the great God,
right?
He's the Avalokiteshvara. Ishvara is still God.
Sure.
But Avalokita means looking down nervously, like, what's happening to those beings?
Yeah, right.
What are they doing? Are they going to elect Donald Trump? Oh, no. Send Shiva. Send Shiva. Send Rudra. You know,
send
don't
Rudra.
Even send,
wipe this
send
guy.
Hanuman. So that's a beautiful Indian thing. See, the Indian thing is everybody emanates as everybody else.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
So then they can still feel good about their thing, but then the other guy is their thing in another form. You know, they all do that.
Yeah.
That's the Buddhist thing in India. That's how they get along.
Sure. Well, there's only one thing going on.
That's right. Love. Clear light of bliss. That's it.
I'll take some. If anybody's got any, please see me later.
You know, Maharaj-ji, you know, Baba Ram Das, you know, in those days he was Richard Alpert, you know, he had like a pale green Mercedes convertible and he'd drive around him.
Yeah.
And in that Be Here Now, I don't know if you remember, he gets stuck in the East River Drive with Geshe Wangyal in the left-hand seat, snoozing there while he's freaking out because his car stalled there, you know.
Yeah.
And then he goes to India and he meets Maharaj-ji, has them on two pages there, the two of them.
You know, one time I was sitting with Maharaj-ji, and he looked, he saw my diary, my book, you know, my notebook.
Yeah.
So he grabs it, and he goes through pages and pages and pages. He says, what's this? And I looked at it, and it was the Song of Mahamudra.
Oh, really?
Which I had written out, you know.
Yeah.
And I looked at him, and I said, it's Buddhist. And I thought, I'm going to get busted. He's going to hit me with a puri or something, you know. So he said, translate some of it, right? So I couldn't, but there was an Indian guy there who started. Translated a bunch of the verses, and Maharaj-ji looked at me and said, Teek, correct. And I went, what? And then he kept going through the book, and he sees a little picture of himself. And he said, who's that? I said, Maharaj-ji, it's you. He goes, nay, Buddha.
Really?
Yeah.
Very good. That's very good.
Yeah, well, he ought to know. So,
I think that's the real thing.
Yeah.
That is the real thing.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah. Okay. Just let me say one thing about Rama and Sita.
Yes. Oh, good.
They're not two things. They're not two different beings.
Okay.
There's one being. Sitaram is one being.
Right.
It's not two people.
I know, but why didn't he just know that she was faithful to him?
Because somebody had to kidnap her.
Yeah, I know.
And then she had
big
to be
ugly guy with 10 heads.
10 heads, yeah. And
not
then
really
Rama had to go save her. And in doing so, he eradicated all the evil from the world.
Yeah.
And who went and found her? She who is the soul, and Rama who is the Paramatman, the supreme.
Sure.
You know, who was the one who found her? Hanuman.
Yes.
Right? So
sure.
It's the connection. Maharaj used to say Hanuman is the breath of Ram.
I told you the Tibetans think that they descended from Hanuman, but of course they think Hanuman is Avalokiteshvara.
Huh.
You know, the union of the monkey bodhisattva, monk-monkey bodhisattva.
Monk-monkey.
And the Himalayan rock goddess produced the Tibetan nation. You know, they believe that. They do.
Yeah,
so Hanuman is like created the Tibet. You know?
Right. She saw this, the monkey god meditating, she fell in love with him, right?
Yeah.
And then she said, if you don't marry me, I'm going to kill myself.
That's right.
So he appealed.
Then he asked himself, the celestial form of Avalokiteshvara, he asked him, he said, can I give up my monk's vow and stop being a monk monkey to marry this goddess, because she's going to kill herself if I don't?
Uh-huh.
And I believe she will. And he said, of course, what are you talking about?
Yeah, that's the kind of boss you want to have.
So he did that. What?
That's the kind of boss you want to have.
But that is the Tibetan legend. It really is.
Yeah, it's amazing, yeah.
The monk monkey.
Okay.
Hanuman. And Hanuman brings the Himalayan medicine back to heal all the soldiers who were killed by Ravana's army.
Yeah.
So he brings the whole Kailash back.
Well, he went to get the mountain and the herbs hid from him.
Right.
So instead he said, okay, you're going to play with me? And he picks up the whole mountain.
Exactly.
Carries it down to South India.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yes, I am there.
Rama, Rama,
What? And I was just thinking of Allan Ginsberg, you know, dear Allan, you know.
Yeah.
And he brought back from India, from his early trip, that famous mantra, Om 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 Sarvabhuta Dakiniya Vajravananiya Vajravarajaniya Hum 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 Pe 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 Swaha. Do you remember that?
No.
He used to play that with the harmonium, but I can't remember the melody he used.
I don't know.
But I was always surprised. I asked him, and he never gave me a clear answer where he heard that.
Huh?
Because he had a very early trip, right, with Gary Snyder, that early time.
Yeah, yeah.
And he found that mantra somewhere. That's a wonderful, like, Chakrasambara mantra. Om, om, om.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's like a Uma mantra, you know.
Uma. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And why is that?
Parvati Uma.
Yeah. How is that?
Vajrayogini Vajradakini.
Vajrayogini. Uh-huh.
Om, 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 Sarvabhuta. But tell us a story about Maharaj-ji, please. One of your stories of Maharaj-ji.
I'm trying to find something relevant to what we're doing here.
What? What?
I'm trying to find something relevant to what we're actually been talking
about. It doesn't matter, whatever it is.
You know, he fed people. You know Lama Norla from Wappingers Falls?
Yeah, Lama Norla, sure.
You know that Lama Norla, one day Lama Norla had escaped from Tibet and was wandering around India. And he found a little kutir outside of Haridwar in the hills. And he just moved in there, old broken down kutir.
Really?
Yeah. And so he's just getting settled. And somebody shows up and starts yelling at him and kicking his stuff around, broke his pot and stuff like that, and then left. And then Lama Norla thought, this must be his place and maybe I should leave. But he decided to stay because he didn't have anywhere to go. A couple of hours later, some Indian people arrived with tea and chai and biscuits and stuff like that, snacks. And they give them to Lama Norla and then they go away. A couple hours later, they come back and they said, there's this Baba staying near here and he wants you to come for a meal. And Lama Norla, you know, hadn't eaten, so he said, fine, wonderful. So he goes to this house, Indian, and it's the guy who was kicking his shit around in the morning.
Really?
Maharaj-ji.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
And Maharaj-ji loved Lama Norla so much, he called him Tibeti Baba.
Really?
And he had, for 2 years, he kept Lama Norla with him, or he kept
really?
Him, gave him a place to stay in people's houses, and he always had his own room so he could do his puja and everything. Lama Norla himself told me the story. Danny, he told me.
Yeah, but why did he kick the stuff around first?
I don't know.
Did he ever
know.
Tell him? Did he ever explain
maybe
what it was?
Maybe there were snakes there or something. He was trying to tell him to, you know, to be careful. Or who knows? Maharaj-ji had his way of doing things. How do I know what he did?
That's beautiful.
So then one morning, they were living in either in a temple or in somebody's house. One morning, early in the morning, he's banging on Lama Norla's door. He opens the door, and it's Maharaj-ji. And Maharaj-ji says, "Don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. Whatever they say, don't listen to them." And he goes away. What's this? Later that day, Kalu Rinpoche's brother arrives there at this place, this house. Lama Norla had been in touch with him. Rinpoche, Kalu Rinpoche had gotten out of Tibet and was probably in Darjeeling, I think. And
yes,
he wanted, Lama Norla had been his retreat master. And he wanted Lama Norla to come back and start running his retreats.
I see.
So Lama Norla comes to Maharaj and said, "Baba, you know, they want me to go back." And he said, "Don't go. Don't go. We'll stay together our whole lives. We love each other so much. It's so great. We'll be together." Lama Norla said, "But Baba, he's my guru. You must go." He said, "If you don't go, your sadhana will bring no fruit."
Really?
Yeah. So, but then Lama Norla says to him, "But Baba, we'll meet again." Maharaj-ji says, "Yes, we'll meet again, but after you've died."
Really?
Yeah. Lama Norla himself told me this. So last year, a very old devotee of Maharaj-ji's came to America, K.K. Shah, who, wonderful, great devotee. And we took him to meet Lama Norla, and it was like a love fest. It was so beautiful.
Really?
And K.K., you know, he never bows to anybody.
I see.
Down like that, you know.
Really?
Beautiful. So I said, "Lama Norla, did you and Maharaj-ji discuss philosophy?" And he said, "Oh, yes, we discussed very much." I said, "Really?" And then Lama Norla said, "He liked my view."
He liked his view?
Yeah. Then he said, "But he liked his view better." I would have loved to be love to hear those discussions.
What?
I would have loved to hear those discussions.
Oh, yes.
Lama Norla said Maharaj-ji was the greatest siddha in the Himalayas, and that everywhere he went, he fed people. And he used to say, "Who will feed my people when I'm gone? Who will feed my people when I'm gone?"
Oh, that's lovely.
Yeah. And he used to feed us. You can't imagine the mountains of puris and potatoes we had to eat, you know. He would say, feed them, give them more, until they get sick and then call the doctor.
I see it here.
Yeah, he fed everybody who came, everybody.
Casey Wongyal was big on feeding too.
Yeah.
But I think a little different kind of food, really. But anyway, yeah, he was very big on feeding. Mm. And then he would scold people if they wasted food.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. He never scolded people about making a mistake of view or doing some wrong meditation or anything. He was very indulgent. But if they put too much soy sauce on some momo, you are destroying my monastery. You're destroying the Dharma, you know. He would really go crazy over these small little things, you know. It was a great, you know, upaya, you know,
sure.
Strategy. Like, show the character flaws about the way that you did your soy sauce.
Sure. I never thought soy sauce could destroy the Dharma.
What?
I never thought that soy sauce could destroy the Dharma, but, you know.
Wasting it. You know.
Yeah, wasting it.
You know, self-indulgently splattering
it
on.
Yeah, yeah,
like,
too much.
Blah, you know, like American style. You know.
Yeah.
He was very big on that.
Yeah.
Too bad they didn't meet, but they both passed away now. So.
Yeah, yeah.
Their meeting. But Maharaj-ji never spoke of being reborn anywhere?
He never spoke about anything like that. You know, they say, "Baba, how can we find God?" He said, "Serve people."
Right.
Excuse me? You know, here we were. We wanted to be yogis and we wanted to do practices.
I know.
So he said, "Baba, how do you raise kundalini?" You know, we figured, now, you know. He said, "Feed people." He said, "Love everyone, serve everyone. And remember God." He liked us to repeat the name of God.
Absolutely.
He said over and over, "Ram nam karne se sab pura ho jata."
Ram nam.
Ram nam karne se sab pura ho jata. From repeating the names of God, everything is made complete.
Mm-hmm.
Brought to fullness and completion.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, and he knew we were unqualified for anything. He used to say the Westerners, you know, Ashtanga Yoga, the eight-limbed yoga. He said the Westerners were qualified for the five-limbed yoga, Panchtanga Yoga.
Five-limbed?
Kane, pine, sone, gupangumne.
What's that?
Eating, drinking, sleeping, gossiping, and wandering around.
Really? That's
about
pretty
it.
Good.
That's what we do? What to say? What can you say?
That's very good.
He'd just look at us and go, oh, God. One time, you know, he walked like a baby. You know, he would bounce from one leg to the other. It looked like he was going to fall over. So people would always take his hand and walk with him, right? So one day, the Westerners never really did that at this point. But one day he got up and there was nobody else around. So I stood up and I put my hand out. He grabbed my hand. He said, Jello, let's go. So we walked towards the back of the temple. And then we got to the back of the temple. We're alone. And then he lets go of my hand and he takes a few steps. So I took a few steps. And he said something to me in Hindi. Of course, I didn't understand. And he took a few steps. So I took a few steps. Then he said something again in Hindi and took a few steps. And then I took a few steps. Finally, he just went like, yeah. And he picks up his lungi and he kneels down and he pees. He just wanted about 3 inches to pee and I wasn't going to give it to him. You know? He got the look on his face like, oh, God. It was like the Hindu version of, ay, gut.
That was really great.
But he was very kind to us, you know.
Very what? Very kind?
Very kind to us, yeah. He really, he let us cook in the temple. Nobody, but in most monasteries and ashrams, only the Brahmins would cook.
Oh, yeah.
He let us cook.
Oh, that's great.
The Westerners, and let us give out prasad. Mm-hmm. He let us do things. But he also said, you don't have to do seva in order to get food and be here. You should feel like you're coming to your grandfather's house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything is given to you. You don't have to do seva to do that. But he would, when some of the Indian people didn't necessarily like taking food from our hands, he would be sitting right there like this. And they go. Like he was very kind to us. And you know, he knew everything. Everything. He knew everything you've ever done, everything you would ever do, everything you were thinking. And he would look at you and he'd go. You know, what am I getting busted for, you know? Something I did, something I'm going to do, or something I'm thinking of doing, you know? But he was doing this all the time. And so finally somebody said, Baba, what does it mean when you do that? And he went.
What?
So we said, what does that mean? And he goes, many names, many forms, all one.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So the whole time we thought he was saying you, he was just pointing out, you know.
It's all one.
All one. That's what it came down to with him, you know. It's Sabek. He used to say, we're all one family. The same blood runs through all of our veins.
Totally.
Yeah.
Totally. One thing. How beautiful. It's so beautiful how he is with you all the time. My guru too, Geshe Wangyo, was with me like that.
Yeah.
Kindness is amazing.
Yeah.
You must have had times when you were frightened of him or you were angry with him. He did something you didn't like.
He did something I didn't like all the time.
Very good training.
He would run away from us, you know. We'd be at the temple with him for months, every day. And then one day, he would head across the courtyard like he used to go to his other room across the courtyard. Then we'd make a right turn slide right out of the temple over the bridge. There'd be a jeep waiting. He'd get in the jeep and he'd drive away.
I remember that bridge. Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, and we're just like, and we said, where did he go? Nobody knew. When is he coming back? Nobody knew. And there we were. We're stuck in India, you know, and our... so that's how we got to Bodh Gaya and started meditating. He had disappeared. What else are we going to do, you know? No TV, nothing else to do. We went to Bodh Gaya.
And he didn't come back for months and months?
That particular time, he didn't come back for like 6 months.
Really?
Yeah. But we met him somewhere else. We met him in Allahabad, and 3 months later.
I see. Where?
In Allahabad.
Allahabad.
You know, he was...
The guru relationship.
And, you know, people, I have to say, a lot of Western Buddhists that I meet tend to be a little dry.
Oh, yeah, what? Oh, Western Buddhists?
Yeah. They tend to be a little bit, you know, heady.
I see.
And they, not you.
Yeah. Well, I was lucky. I think they meditate too much sometimes.
Sometimes too much meditation is not good for you, huh?
You know, my guru had a clairvoyance, and he would know when I was meditating.
Yeah.
And he would invariably show up just when the mind was slipping away from the body into some quiescent state. No, really, he would absolutely show up.
I'm sure.
What are you doing? You know, completely disturbed me.
Yeah.
And I got to where I would run away in the woods and try to meditate, and he would come in the woods.
Oh.
He would show up. Say, we have to plant it. What are you looking for? We should plant over there in the garden at nighttime.
Really?
Yes. He totally disturbed my meditating.
How dare he?
And then I was so frustrated. And like years later, I realized, you know, that I would have become that sort of, you know, I would have had that place where I go so quiet, nobody bothering me, you know. And then it would have been sort of very touchy to be out there with the...
Yeah.
That's why you feel it's like a drive, because they're always thinking of going somewhere else.
Yeah.
Like nirvana, somewhere over the hill, around the corner.
Yeah.
But non-dual means it's all here.
Yeah.
So he saw my escapist attitude.
Yeah.
In other words.
Yeah, yeah.
And he totally persecuted my meditating. He finally, I told you that story. You know that story where he caught me even after I was a monk?
Huh, yeah.
3 a.m, sneaked into the temple and lit a candle. And I was really feeling, you know, I've been studying a lot, and I was a monk, and meditating away, you know, and I was really concentrating. And suddenly, light switch on, you know, what are you doing? Like, what do you mean, what am I doing? I'm meditating. Says, why are you meditating? I said, what do you mean, why am I meditating? I'm trying to attain enlightenment. He said, oh, he says, you can't attain enlightenment, you're an American. And then I said, well, what do you mean I'm American? I'm not American, I'm a monk. You know, I know Tibetan, I believe in future life, I'm like, you know, I'm not a materialist, you know, what I'm meditating, I want to take enlightenment. He said, yeah, but you're an American, he said, and you know, what attains enlightenment is your mind, and you Americans don't think you have one. And I was like, what? I'm not like that. And we went on for weeks arguing, you know. But then he dragged me off to have yogurt and argue at 4 a.m. But he was, you know, and I finally realized he was right, because we have this idea that the mind is something, the brain, you know, we're this robots, we're brainwashed to think that, and we have a subliminal idea like that.
Yeah.
So we don't really think the mind can really take over and make mind over matter. We don't really believe it.
No.
We don't. Maybe we break down at our age, you know, we kind of...
A lot of other things are breaking down. Maybe that'll break down too. You know.
but it's really hard. It's a big effort to clear that away.
I always
say... That sense of being a helpless robot.
I always say, we grew up with Mickey Mouse.
Yes.
And it's a long way from Mickey Mouse to Ram. You know?
That's right.
You know, it really... To get to the point where there's reality... You know, from we don't believe it.
Yeah, that's true.
We don't believe it.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
The violence. I think there's some. I went to this organization called Common Sense in Media.
Right.
And it's a great nonprofit, and they have some calculation, like young little kids, when they watch that TV, you know, those cartoons and things, there's like every hour there's 7 instances of extreme violence, even in cartoons.
Yeah, sure.
And it's completely integrated into the thing. Terrible.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
It's terrible. Anyway, we're lucky we had such nice people. Everyone should have such kind and nice people. And everyone does somewhere.
Yeah.
But the great ones, I think, don't do what you expect. No. They don't.
How could they? How could we know what they're going to do? I mean, it's beyond. And it's the relationship with the guru is really a love relationship.
Yeah, sure.
You know, it's in that loving connection that the transmission happens. And I think that's what, you know, a lot of Westerners don't understand that. First of all, if we don't love ourselves, how are we going to love somebody else?
Yeah.
How are we going to establish a loving relationship if we don't know how to accept love ourselves and do the right thing for ourselves? It's very difficult for us. Very difficult. We want to do, but we don't want to. We can't receive.
When I first met that Geshe Bongyal, you know, there was some sort of feeling of power and energy in this little house in New Jersey where he lived. Had a little piece of plywood with a Dharma chakra and 2 deers painted on it. So I'd driven by it 5 times before I recognized it, you know, because I was looking for a monastery.
Oh.
But I felt this big energy in the house. And then when I first saw him, I didn't think he was the energy. I thought he was the secretary of some big lama in the back who was riding on a dragon or something. No, I had that fantasy.
Yeah, sure.
And this little guy, and he had a little like kimono thing, came out and offered some pie and tea and asked me what I wanted. And then I realized it was him. I became really tongue-tied. You know. But then when I left, I said, "That's my guru. I'm going there." And my friend who had driven me said, "Well, why do you think that? Why? You're going back to India." And I said, "Well, I didn't even know what I was saying, but I said, he's my guru because he's not there for himself. So therefore, I can trust him completely." And he was like that. You know, you could feel it. He was seva. You know? Yeah. He was just there to serve people.
When you actually have the grace to meet someone who isn't all about themselves.
I know.
It's like night and day.
It's weird.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who doesn't want anything for themselves? Who doesn't even have a self to want anything for? You know, I mean, it's such an extraordinary experience.
It is.
Yeah, it's such a grace to meet those. That kind of.
Did I tell you about how His Holiness blew my mind in Switzerland?
No.
Recently, he was there were maybe 10,000 people in a big place there, and he was giving a teaching, and I was sitting on the side because I wasn't. As usual, didn't have time to go to teaching, but I had to meet him, you know. But I sneaked into this one session. So he's giving this teaching. Then he comes to that verse from the Buddha, quote from the Buddha, where it says, you know, mendicants, referring to the bhikshus, you know, mendicants, a wise person accepts my teaching after thorough evaluation. Like a goldsmith only buys gold after cutting, melting, and rubbing it on a touchstone to assure that it's real gold, and not just out of devotion to me. No. In other words, like Buddha said, so you know, I'm going to do that. And so he was doing that. He was begging the audience, basically. He ended up in commenting on that verse, begging the audience, please think about what I'm saying, doubt it, criticize it in your mind, wrestle with it, and make it your own or reject it. But don't just say, oh, Dalai Lama said so. You know, please do that. And then he said, I can even imagine Shakyamuni Buddha when he said this. He was begging his students to use what he was telling them and to put it into their lives, you know, and not just say, oh, Buddha said that. And as he did that, he had a body language like a waiter in a Chinese restaurant, you know, like, please, you know, like, please do that, like that.
Yeah. Oh.
And I was sitting over here, and there were a bunch of those dry people that you're talking about, but these were masters, gurus, because the gurus on the seat. Some of the old lamas there were genuinely, like, touched by them, by it, you know. But there were some people who were teachers,
yeah,
and they were sitting up kind of looking nervous, Because the idea that the teacher is the servant of the student, you follow, rather than the master of the student, was like freaking them out.
Yeah.
And they were thinking about probably their students in the audience.
Their mortgage, too.
What?
Their mortgage.
Exactly. Exactly. So that's really a beautiful thing, you know, true non-duality.
Yeah.
You know? So you were right. You reproved me very well, you've cured me of my little critical feeling about Rama, because Rama and Sita are one thing.
Oh, absolutely.
Because any enlightened being, what enlightenment means is that that being is all the other beings.
Yeah.
Right? So therefore, they're not sitting there being something different than the other beings.
Right?
Right? Mm-hmm. They feel they are all the other.
Sure.
And they're only manifesting, like Vishnu, Shiva, Buddha, they don't need to have a body and sit around and hang around and stagger out and try to get away from some disciple so they can see. they really don't need to.
Right.
Because they don't have to have a body at all, because they're a vast ocean of bliss, right?
These great beings, all of the great beings,
yes,
only are in a body for us.
Yeah, exactly.
Period.
Yeah. And they're not quite just in the body, right?
They're not?
No, but they're in our body.
Right.
They're in everybody else's body at the same time.
Of course.
Ideally.
Yeah.
Right?
Of course.
Yeah. And I think they are.
But in other words, they're not here for any personal gain or personal need or desire. They're here because we're suffering.
Yeah.
It's the only reason.
We used to.
Yeah.
No, we still are, really.
You know.
No, but we're suffering more happily, that's all. Right? We're enjoying our misery more.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
No, seriously. Don't you enjoy your misery? I do. Come on.
At times, you know.
What?
At times.
Gives you material. Right? But.
Yeah, sometimes I'm
open. You have to reassure people that you're miserable.
Yes. Yeah.
If you don't want to let on if you're feeling really good.
God forbid.
What?
God forbid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah, God. That's true.
I don't know. Sometimes I mope around just for fun.
What?
Sometimes I mope around just for fun.
I think so.
Yeah.
Does he do that? I think he does. I bet he does. Oh, okay.
There are plenty of people who attest to that.
Somebody goes to the doctor. That's right. Yeah, the other thing he did, when he took me to Dharamsala to be a monk, he arrived before he left with the Dalai Lama's doctor, Yishidanden. Hmm. And was dragging him over to see me. And Yishidanden looked like a Garuda bird. He had this cheekbone that went right on the line of his ears like that. He looked like that kind of Garuda bird, totally. Which is a symbol of healing, you know, the Garuda takes the snake of disease, you know.
Right.
And he said, you study medicine with him. He was Mongolian, you know.
Yeah.
I said, what do you mean? I don't want to study medicine. I came here to be a monk. I want to meditate on emptiness. I want enlightenment. I want to get away from you so I can meditate. And he said, but I didn't say that. But he said, no, you do that later. He said, you do that later. I'll take care of that later. He said, you wait till you're older. Now you study medicine. You study medicine. You need to know medicine. And it actually was totally true. So I had to do it. And I finally discovered after, you know, St. Bernard's here in New York, Phillips Exeter, Harvard, certain number of years, and I finally discovered I had a kidney. And what kidneys were, what they do, and a liver, and a spleen. And we have no idea.
Right?
All that education, but you know, unless you're a pre-med or something, you know, and you're going to go and make some money, serious money, and be a high priest over people's lives, you have no idea. They don't bother to tell you that.
Right?
Only experts should know you have a kidney.
Yeah.
And you're Tibetan, you right away learn you have a kidney. And it's like right there. Yeah, and it's sort of flapping. It's like a little butterfly back there.
Mm-hmm.
Flapping its wings, trying to purify things, and helps your hearing, you know, it's like really, if it goes bad, then your hearing goes bad. You know? And then you learn that in Tibetan medicine, it's really nice. So, so he made me do that ground level kind of thing.
Sure.
Always.
I know what you mean. Yeah.
Never let me meditate. Seriously. Meditating is not good for you if you have the stupid ideas in your head. No, really. It's really bad for you. Because what happens is you sit there with this stupid idea that, like, I'm so great, but nobody knows it, and someday, you know, they'll really recognize it, and I'll really, and they'll agree that I'm so great.
Right.
If that's sort of there, you then meditate for many years, yeah. And then guess what happens after 10 years of that?
Yeah.
Eureka, I'm so great. Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Have you run into any gurus like that?
Hmm? What's that?
Well, there's who are great.
Yeah.
Yeah. And seem to think so.
Oh, I've met a lot of gurus who think they're
what?
Great. Yeah. I've
met
a lot
of... You
a few? Yeah. They think they're really great. And then they wind up in jail.
Anyway, never mind. Okay.
Okay.
Hare Krishna, Hare Hare. Krishna, Krishna.
Do you really
do, do any chant from Gita Govinda? Do you
what?
Any Gita Govinda chant? Do you have any Gita
no.
Govinda?
You mean the actual Sanskrit Gita? No, I don't know that.
You know the one where Radha is mad? I mean, yeah, Radha is mad.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he's been fooling around with gopis.
Yeah.
And then she won't talk to him, and then her friend, the Sakhi, you know, the companion goes and tells him, maybe you can make up with her if you go over there and you really show some...
The whole love dance.
Repentance and so on. Do you know that?
Those, I know the story and I know the poems, but I don't know how
you
to
don't
sing
chant
those bhajans. Those
I think it's really beautiful.
It's too complicated. I just sing the same damn thing over and over again. And over and over.
They're
and over.
Wonderful. Yeah. That's all you need to do. That's all.
How about
What?
How about Tara's mantra?
Okay. Tare. Everybody know Tara mantra? You all know it? Anybody not know it? Tare tu tare ture.
Om Tare. Tu tare.
Om Tare.
Tare. Swaha.
Yeah. Om tare, tu tare, om tare, tu tare, ture, swaha. Om tare, tu tare, ture, swaha. Om tare, tu tare, ture, swaha. I don't know your melody, you start with that. Om tare, tu tare, ture, swaha. Om tare, tu tare, ture, swaha. But everyone, come on. Om tare tu tare ture swaha. Om tare tu tare ture swaha. Om tare tu tare ture swaha.
Om tare tu tare ture.
Bye. You know the story when I would look at this brother was meditating, and he took responsibility for the Tibetans in one sutra. He told Amitabha, the Buddha of infinite light, that he would try to tame the Tibetans, who, you know, because they were the offspring of the Hanuman and the rock ogress, tended to be playful and but a little bit naughty and wild and rough, you know. And he said, "I will go and take care of them, and I will see to it that they become kind and loving and wise and compassionate and so forth." And he went and meditated, and he said, "If I ever become discouraged, then, you know, may my head be split in pieces and my body torn to shreds." He made a vow like that in front of Amitabha. So then he went and he meditated, and then he meditated life after life, century after century, and the Tibetans were still, it's like in prehistory, like legendary time. Mm. Tibetans were still a bit naughty, you know. And so he became discouraged and he wept. And then the two tears, one became green tara and one became white tara.
Ah.
And they told him, they said, "Well, listen, Chenrezig, you know, Avalokiteshvara, you know, no wonder you can't really straighten out these people. You're a man. Well, you can pray, but you can't get much done. But we're here, don't worry. We'll take care of it." So tara is considered the incarnation, or like Avalokiteshvara is considered the incarnation of the infinite compassion of all Buddhas.
Yeah.
So, and so tara is considered the incarnation of the infinite miraculous power of all Buddhas.
Wow.
So miracle working, you know, tara is. Mm. And there's thousands of millions of taras, you know. They're everywhere, you know, all the taras.
Huh.
They're really great. And then tari tu tari, you know, tari is savioress, right? The tara means savioress, like a savior, you know.
Yeah.
And then tu tari, you know, om tara, you know, tu tari means come save me. And ture means quick, quickly, right away.
Oh.
Pretty damn quick.
I have to sing that more.
And then all hail.
What? I have to sing that more.
So they're really wonderful tara.
That's
really
beautiful.
Tara.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
There was Atisha, the great master, the teacher who went to Tibet in the 11th century, who was a Bengali prince. He had a statue of tara that he held with him, and she would always talk to him. The statue would talk to him, tell him what to do.
Huh.
And she would scold him often. And he was at Bodh Gaya one time, and he was doing prostrations, saying mantras, and he was pilgrimage to him. So she said to him, "Oh, Atisha, it's nice that you're doing this pilgrimage, saying mantras and prostrating, but why aren't you practicing the Dharma?" And he said, "What do you mean? I'm just practicing the Dharma." He says, no, but you're not practicing the Dharma." And then he said, "Well, why do you say I'm not practicing the Dharma?" She said, "Because your bodhicitta sucks." She said, "Well, what do you mean my bodhicitta sucks? What? I know about bodhicitta. Like, say, I'm going to save all beings, make them all happy, you know, free of suffering. I'm going to become a Buddha for their sake, and in one of my lives somehow soon." So yeah, but you didn't really receive the real teaching, because nobody in all of India can teach the bodhicitta anymore. "Really?" He said. "Well, is there anyone on the world who can do it?" Yeah, she said, the guy, he went to Indonesia,
really?
Java, yeah.
Wow.
And this is the 11th century.
Uh-huh.
So then, okay, should I go there? Yeah, you better go there. So then he went to Sumatra, actually, where they had this Suvarnadvipa, the Tibetans called Golden Island.
Uh-huh.
And then he met Dharmakirti of Suvarnadvipa, who taught him the bodhicitta.
Wow.
Then he brought that all the way back, and then he finally went to Tibet and took it to Tibet with him just before everybody got trampled in India temporarily.
Yeah.
You know, at that end of the first millennium.
Hmm. I met Khunu Rinpoche.
You did?
In Bodh Gaya in 1970.
I'm so jealous. I never met him.
Yeah, he lives in the Dalai Lama's lap, and he's jealous of me.
Yeah, I am.
Can you explain that? You know?
But he was Dalai Lama's root teacher of the compassion teaching of bodhicitta.
I was there in Bodh Gaya.
No wonder you're telling me to check my bodhicitta. My bodhicitta sucks. Really?
What are you going to do about it?
I know. Well, I'll have to get more serious.
Let me tell you this. You asked about a Maharaj-ji story. So this is So I was in Bodh Gaya, and we heard that in room 4 of the Buddhist temple, there was this old Lama, Khunu Rinpoche. So we went to see him.
Yeah.
Danny and I.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah. And we walk in, and he's supposed to be this great Lama, right? And he's this little old guy sitting there like this, you know. And there's nothing fancy in the room at all. Everything's old and used and everything, and he's just sitting like this. And so we sat down, he smiled at us, and he had these real thick glasses. And so he decided to give us mantra.
Yeah.
So, and I'm doing this with all love and respect, because I, it's okay. He goes, Om Nam Nyasa. I looked at Danny, he looked at me. We said, Baba, please say, oh my God, you know, what are we going to do? We're here getting mantra and we don't know what it is. We can't even understand, you know. So finally, it was explained to us very slowly. We got the mantra. So, and then as we're getting ready to leave, he reached into his thing. He pulls out from his little sack, you know, he reaches in. Pulls out a seed from the Bodhi tree. And he gives one to me, and he gives one to
Danny. That's so great. You and Dan, both.
Yeah, and actually there were two other guys there. So I went to put it away, to save it. And he looked at me and said, no, eat it now, right? So I eat it. So I had to eat it. It almost broke my teeth. I think that's why my teeth are falling out today. So I ate it, and then I left. Now, this was in the Christmas of 1970. So then we started doing those the Goenka courses and the Vipassana courses. We were knocking them off.
Oh, yeah, because Maharaj-ji left, right?
Yeah, because this is when he ran away.
Right.
Ramdas showed up. And anyway, 2 years pass.
Yes.
And I find myself in a Bombay hotel room with Maharaj-ji on Christmas, right? And we're sitting there for hours. And he's just lying on the bed, and he'd sit up, and then he'd lie down again this way. Then he'd sit up, and all I'm doing is just like, much my meditation, it's like. And then he'd sit up, and then he'd lie down this way, right? And at one point, he sits up and looks at me and said, give me the seed the Lama gave you. I said, Lama? What Lama? What seed? I don't know. Give me the seed the Lama gave you. Really?
Really?
I didn't know what he was talking about. And then, Khunu Lama, the seed. I said, Baba, he made me eat it. He goes, Acha, theek hai, ab mukti ho jayega. He said, good, now you'll be enlightened. And then he laid down and went back to sleep.
That's so awesome. I like it. That's really great.
Isn't that amazing?
I love that. Do you know the story of how Dalai Lama met him?
No.
Well, it's in our comic book.
Oh, okay.
We have a beautiful thing of that.
Beautiful. Okay.
But what it is that his teacher, Serkun Rinpoche, one of his tutors, told him, you know, you have to go find that Khunu Lama Rinpoche. And who was not an official lama of any kind.
He wasn't from, he was from Himachal Pradesh, Khunu.
Yeah, he was from there. But yeah. And then he was in Tibet many, many years.
Uh-huh.
And he used to make a living in Tibet by teaching poetry, because he was new Sanskrit, Kavya, the poetic.
Yeah, right.
But then he went around looking for teachers, and he finally found one of the students of Patu Rinpoche, Nyingma. Ooh. Although he was before that in Teshe Lumbo and all different monasteries teaching a high lama. And then that student taught him, gave him this personal precept of the bodhicitta, of the spirit of enlightenment, of love and compassion for all beings, coming from Shantideva, Nagarjuna and Shantideva.
Uh-huh.
The Manjushri version of the way of generating the spirit of compassion in the uh-huh. bodhicitta, right? So it's a special thing, you know, like a uh-huh. lineage, oral lineage. So he said, you should go get that from him, although he's not in the official teaching list kind of thing. And in fact, he was a layman by that time, and he taught Sanskrit poetics at Sanskrit University of Varanasi. That's what he was doing. He was, because he was Indian citizen the whole time. So his holiness saw him here and there, and saw him in Bodh Gaya somewhere, and he wanted to studied with him and sort of couldn't connect, you know. And so then he went purposely and gave a talk at Sanskrit University, hoping to see him among the faculty, and he wasn't there. So he would, and he would make an appointment, and I want to come and get teaching from you. So he didn't come to His Holiness's teaching. So then His Holiness was very disappointed. He was driving home in the street in Varanasi. And then the teacher was with him in the car, and he said, oh, there he is, he's walking in the street. So His Holiness stopped the car. The whole flit, it was a smaller than now it was, small cortege, you know, whatever. And he jumps out of the car and runs over to him with a katak, and he offers the katak, and he bows down in the street to Khunu Lama Rinpoche, with all everybody gawking, and like Dalai Lama bowing down the street to this simple, he wasn't even a monk's robe. And so that Khunu Lama Rinpoche ran away. He said, okay, and he ran away. So then that the Dalai Lama got really pissed off. So they had him call up there, where's his home address, where does the guy live? He went to his house, he went up 5-floor walk up, went into a room, there was no furniture, pounded on a metal door, you know, those kind of Indian door. Pounded on the door, and then the guy opened it timidly, and then there was, no, you can't come in here, there's no furniture, there's no place for you to sit, I don't care, I'm getting this teaching, I want the teaching of love and compassion.
Oh, wow.
Bodhicitta, for all beings. And then he did teach him, you know, then he had a whole transmission with him.
Wow.
A real, and a real, you know, somewhat lengthy teaching.
Beautiful.
And it was like so, it was completely off the scale, that was. You know? So then His Holiness, when he does that, that's why thousands of people, when they go there, then they hear this thing, and then he teaches the Shantideva thing about exchange of self and other, right?
Yeah.
Like, which one are you?
Right.
Are you the one facing the people, or are you the people facing you?
Huh.
And when he does that, and you really listen to it, you kind of get nervous because you're not sure which one is in the room you are, if you really listen to it. Like, which one? In which face are you looking out of, looking at everybody else? That's the atmosphere. That's the atmosphere of that transmission. And which one are you? Are you really the you that is there thinking all the time, like, how am I doing? What am I getting? How happy am I? Am I getting my money's worth? What is it? Is it? What? Who? What? Meanwhile, it's all not enough. It's not good enough. I don't have enough. I don't have what I really wanted. Oh, it was so good yesterday. Oh, it could be great tomorrow. Oh. So you're just totally like in agony of like lack of sufficient resonance from the universe of your own like tremendous self-appreciation.
I didn't know you knew me that well.
What? So, but the thing is, everybody is like.
Yeah.
So then this precept is where you feel that you feel the other people that way, and then they look at you. Mm. And then you see how they see you. Mm. And then it makes you, if you try that practice, it really gets to you. Because when you know how we are with each other, you know?
Yeah.
Like dogs, you know? Yeah. You know, when we meet somebody, right? Like dogs are really straight out. Right? They go and sniff the other one's ass right away. They don't waste any time. They really don't. But they're checking their diet, whether they're vegan or not. Right? Right? So dogs are like that. But humans, no. When we do it, it's like, oh, are they cooler than me? Am I cooler than them? Are they more beautiful, younger, older, wiser, smarter, richer, poorer? What?
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So then the mind instantly makes judgments. You know, oh, they really need fashion advice, you know, something, whatever. And then, so the minute if you become aware of that habit in yourself, and then you know that the instantly you feel condescending, competitive, or jealous when you meet that other person.
Yeah, right.
And whatever you feel, they feel the opposite.
Mm.
So then exchange of self and other, seeing yourself from their eyes, you know, if you have actually in some subtle way are condescending, then you know that that person sees you like a jealous person sees you. And you see yourself, you should see yourself that way.
Right.
Right? If you feel like subordinate or something and like groveling, you know, like the president or something, but like a good president, like the current one, then you're like, And then you see them looking down at you. how you look, and then equal, you know, instead of competitive. That's a really, at first you're kind of paralyzed with that thing, but that's the exchange of self and other that he passed on to His Holiness. Wow. That's why His Holiness blows everybody away when they meet Him, because He's with them, actually, rather than with Himself more.
Right.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Was that too much? That's too serious. Don't look so serious.
Who, me?
Yeah.
Oh. You're seeing me as serious.
What? No. I don't know what I'm talking about. But it's just, no, it's just Khunu.
I disagree. Khunu. If anybody knows what they're talking about,
Khunu Lama,
it's you.
Rinpoche, this is the beautiful thing of Khunu Lama. And that's why I'm jealous of you, because you met him and you got the seed. You swallowed. That's what you said, which you swallowed it. He told you to swallow it.
He made me, I was going to save it for my little puja table. You know, he said, no, you got to eat it.
He has two reincarnations at the moment, actually.
Acha.
Yeah, there's two of them. At least. Khunu Lama.
Wow.
He does.
He's beautiful.
But they don't know which one is which. They met each other, and they were like,
What happens when they exchange each other for others? What happens when they exchange?
One is official, and one is sort of unofficial.
Oh, really? Wow.
But the unofficial one thinks, and the official one, and it is sort of, by inference, they don't really know. You know?
Yeah.
Anyway. Anaban! Anaban, what a great name! I'm sorry, I just learned her name. It's very hard at my age to remember anybody's name. But it's so, that's a great name. Anaban. I'm sorry, I apologize. Om Mani Padme Hum. Do you like to do Padme or Padme? The Indians would have been, the Mongolians do Padme.
Padme,
and the Indians must have done Padme Hum.
Padme Hum, yeah.
But the Tibetans go Padme.
Padme, yeah.
But they did that long before they heard about English. Somehow the P-A-D, they sound pe. They don't use the stop at the end, you know.
Pe.
Well, but His Holiness scolds them.
Oh.
And he says, it's really, you're saying Om Mani Padme Hum all the time, but it's too much like the American mantra. Om Mani Padme Hum.
Oh, he wants a peme.
A money peme.
Oh, money, give me
money,
some.
Money,
pay me money.
Pay me money. So he scolds him, don't think that when you say, oh, money, pay me home. He does, he tells him. So should we say Padme or Peme when we chant it?
Me?
Yeah.
I do it the Sanskrit way, Padme.
I do too. Yeah. Tibetans get mad at me because I
don't speak Tibetan, so I don't
know
the mantras.
But Tibetans have a thing, you know, they have the famous story about the Dalai Lama. Fifth Dalai Lama, who saw the lady in the market, who Tara was hovering above her, showering her with blessings as she walked around saying her mantra.
Oh, wow.
So he had her called up to his room, and he said, how do you come? You were so blessed by Tara. She says, I didn't know I was blessed. She says, and he says, well, what are you doing? She says, well, I'm reciting Om Tara Turi Swaha. And, oh, that's great. He said, you go and keep doing that. And so then the secretary on the way out says, ma'am, excuse me, but it's Om Tari Tutari Swaha. Don't give me those Om Tari Turi Swaha. That's not right. You have to go Om Tari Tutari Swaha. Oh, she said. So then the next day she was out there, and then Dalai Lama's looking in the spyglass. No Tara.
Oh.
So then he has her called back up. And he says, well, what happened? She says, well, your guy corrected my mantra. He says, go back to the wrong mantra. So they use that story.
Yeah.
And when I go, if I go on Mani Padme home, they're going to give me a hard time. But I think Padme is good, I think, better.
Padme.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can we do a round?
We should do. Let's just do a round. We're just simple, right? All together.
What?
All together.
Sure. Yeah. Oh, you start with a melody and we'll respond.
The melody. That's a whole other thing.
Oh, Mani Padme. What do you do for that? Oh, Mani Padme home.
Give me a second.
That is really cool. So come on, let's hear one for Krishna now. Come on. Krishna. 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 Jaya, 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 Jaya. Radha, Radha, Krishna, Krishna.
Radha, Govinda. Radha, Krishna,
Krishna, Krishna. Come on. Come on now, time for your home, home, home.
Radhe, Radhe, Govinda, Govinda. I
Victory! KD. Good. That's so nice. Thank you so much. Tujiche.
Tujiche. Mahakaruna. Tujiche means Mahakaruna.
Thank you. Tujiche.
Great compassion.
Thank you.
Tujiche. And Tujiche. Tujiche ma Anandama. Anandamai ma. Thank you, everyone, and good night. And next fall, we continue.